Good morning and welcome to the 20th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. Our first item of business is an evidence session with the Board na Gaelic regarding the draft National Gaelic Plan 2023-28. So I would like to welcome this morning Mary McInnes, the Chair. Good morning. Ian McMillan, Director of Development, and Jim Wannell, is that correct? Director of Education for Board na Gaelic. Mary McInnes will be making an opening statement. Before I invite her to do so, I would like to make a few comments. The Scottish Parliament is committed to facilitating the use of the Gaelic language in its proceedings wherever possible. We were keen that Board na Gaelic be able to give their opening statement in Gaelic and sought to make arrangements to support this. However, we were unfortunately unable to secure an interpreter for this morning's meeting. So I am grateful for the Board na Gaelic for working with the Parliament staff to find an alternative option, and grateful to Mary McInnes, who will now deliver the opening statement in Gaelic, which is welcome, before repeating in English. The Parliament is arranging for the official report of this meeting to be translated into Gaelic, so it will be accessible to those in the Gaelic community. I now invite Mary McInnes to make her statement in Gaelic and then in English. Good morning.
Matin va an echgadim evran so gunyushle he the commentator show agus kuchak falte irtunye sebi aha koyet agzikishte. Es mishe mad in ichgunush agus es mi karich a bort na Gaelic. Es kaldadim ha Seamus Swannell aha na studiche fola me gevort agus kuchak ian mach gemulain aha na studiche lisachi e gevort. She urum agus karam a haun gunye a vi edar bialoju agus ha kaharich kutrumach gavil shinye a geishach dishna hakushe dira agus fisrach a horsguiv edar drech flananashanta er sonne Gaelic. She puyun populach let listeners and more han a bors na Gaelic ha skipper gemapik ag shin a heert vuyun rechgal. An the gheith hiet bliana le uolach as an lisach an a Gaelic. Can an agulig le lug agus as joi lug fat ni ginealachin. Lise sin, hana hamasin agus na dúlein a hana an laia de vuyan e de vi mŵr agus dún an a fás a chasin dún an djónach ar lui a chuidara sin. Good morning, convener, committee members and anyone else who may be watching or listening. I'm Mary McInnes. I'm the chair of Board na Gaelic. I've been the chair for over 4 years now. And with me today are Jim Wannell, the Director of Education for Board na Gaelic, and on my left, Ian McMillan, who is Director of Development. I'm the seventh chairperson of the board, and the board has been in existence for around about 16 years now. So, Board na Gaelic is a public body with significant responsibilities. A very small team to deliver them. It's the first statutory body in 4 years with responsibility for developing Gaelic, a language which has suffered from unhelpful legislation in the past. As such, the aims and the expectations which the organisation, Board na Gaelic, carries are significant and continue to increase. In providing evidence to you today around the draft plan, I am pleased to say that Board na Gaelic, as the Auditor General recently noted, is a hugely different organisation today to that which received a very challenging audit report several years ago. The board was considered an example of best practice by our own auditors at the turn of this year. And today, then, we value your input into the national consultation. We are taking the draft plan around the country for people at every level to input into the consultation. And to us, this is a huge opportunity, and we see it as a very important and huge opportunity for this committee as well to feed into the draft national plan. It's the plan that will run for the next 5 years, starting in 2023. And I'd like to hand over to you now so we can continue with the discussion.
Thank you. And just firstly, as you're attending remotely, Ruth, you might not be able to catch my eye. So if you want to have a supplementary or anything you want to chip in, can you put an R in the chat box? Thanks. The clerks will be monitoring that and I'll bring you in when I can. So we'll go around some of the questions now, and the first MSP to bring in is Michael Mara. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. And thank you to the members of the board for attending today. I think the early years of devolution post-99 were marked by some level of anxiety around the long-term future of Gaelic as a key component of our national culture. And that obviously led to the Gaelic Language Act in 2005, which has established the board in 2006. How would you say the board has performed against the desired outcomes that were set out in the Act in 2006?
The board is still young. It's been in existence for about 15, 16 years, and that in terms of the law and the Act and development is relatively short. Particularly, there are a variety of approaches. The board in itself, and also how the board engages with the wider country and all its stakeholders. The board in itself has taken time to settle, and it's no secret that it received a very challenging report around about the 18-19. And as a result of that, a report which was, there was a serious implementation plan, huge improvement plan, and that has all been signed off. And the board today is a very different organisation, completely focused, has a clearer understanding, closer to its communities, and in many ways the opportunities of technology have been hugely grasped by the board, particularly during the lockdown period, and we saw a big shift in how the board enacted and communicated with the communities that it serves. So there's been a huge step change there. In terms of the Act and what it allows the board to do, we are becoming more and more conscious that more needs to be done. The Act needs to be strengthened in our view. The board's powers need to be strengthened in our view. Particularly language plans. The national plan belongs to the country, but the board has the responsibility for writing it, preparing it, consulting on it, and then presenting it to the government. So the national plan is the big picture, but underneath that there is a need for a much more concerted effort at planning level across the country to achieve faster and richer improvement in Gaelic. Is that?
Thank you. That is very useful. I mean, I would appreciate if other members of the panel had comments on that. Any observations you had to set the scene about what you think the long-term prospects are of Gaelic and the Gaelic language. So, you know, increasing the use of Gaelic is certainly at the core of your functions and in that. But where are we as a country in terms of not just preserving but promoting and enhancing the use of the language?
Yes, I'm going to make my colleagues work as well today. So it's a very exciting time for Gaelic. The new plan is coming timely. That is huge ambition. And there are probably two or three things that are key. One prime one is education, which is of big interest to this committee, and Jim will expand on that shortly. And the other one is around general development, community, the plans process itself, and I'll call on Ian to feed in a little bit on that. And just today, there's a very important report coming out, which is what is it called?
Scottish Social Attitude Survey.
The Scottish Social, and that has got very, very positive messages. So, with your permission, I'd like to call on Jim just to give a very quick summary of where we have come with education, Jim.
Yep, and I've got an instruction to be very quick, and Mary's the chair, so I'll do that as quickly as I can. I think if we look at the progress from the early 80s, when there were a handful of children in Gaelic medium education, which was seen as a revolutionary thing and something which was not even particularly tested in this country. That has moved on now. And it's interesting in your briefing report, Gaelic medium education now features within statistical evidence within Scotland, 1% of all children in Gaelic medium education in education in Scotland are educated through the medium of Gaelic. We need to make more progress on that. And when I say we, I mean Scotland, I mean the country. Bord na Gaelic has a very narrow level of ability to influence big issues. Delivery of education resides with local authorities. We promote and we encourage local authorities to provide more opportunities for Gaelic medium education. A majority of local authorities in Scotland either have Gaelic medium education or are developing it, and we are seeing new authorities coming on stream. East Renfrew will be the next one next year, and Renfrew in August, and we are doing work with Fife and are very confident that Fife will also come on stream. I think there's been a huge growth in learners, and learners have moved from traditional delivery, perhaps around night classes, to much greater online access. So Speak Gaelic footfall is just under 400k. Which is massive for the language when you look at the percentage of people who have a Gaelic language skills in our country. Duolingo has been a huge success. And in a comparative way with other languages on an international basis, planning has developed. So local authorities, all local authorities apart from two, are either have a Gaelic language plan or are in the process of developing a Gaelic language plan. Our view would be that significant changes would be required in Gaelic language planning nationally. And we've got a number of ideas around that. Visibility of the language has completely changed. So organisations such as Police Scotland, the ambulance service, the railway system, we note from young kids in Gaelic medium education that they now see Gaelic as part of their lives throughout the country. And that's anecdotally something we heard from young kids in Kilmarnock saying for the first time ever they'd seen Gaelic in Kilmarnock and they hadn't really thought about it before. Sadly, they didn't know Kilmarnock. The word Kilmarnock was a Gaelic word and they didn't know that that's the place they lived in, had a Gaelic place name, and that's quite common in Glasgow. So visibility's increased. Gaelic medium education has increased, and for the first time ever Gaelic medium is now available internationally. The first Gaelic medium service opened in Mabu in Nova Scotia in 2021 and got a lot of support from us in terms of developing that, and that shows international confidence in the language as well, which is really, really gratifying.
I'd like to call Ian just to quickly outline the survey and that is being issued today, the social attitude survey. Comment or two, please.
Yes, I think in terms of evidence that there is improvement. I think the Scottish Social Attitude Survey does show significant improvement, and I think the last time the survey was run, I think, was 2012, and there's been significant change. For example, more than half of those surveyed, 55%. Believe that all children in Scotland between the ages of 5 and 15 should be taught Gaelic as a school subject for between 1 or 2 hours a week. Nearly two-thirds said that they would like to improve their own Gaelic skills, and 70% stated that learning Gaelic gives someone a sense of achievement and contributing to the well-being agenda. You know, the proportion of adults, I think as Jim was saying, that have seen Gaelic signage and that are aware of Gaelic through the media has been growing quite significantly. The proportion of adults who say they can understand a little bit of Gaelic has increased from 25% to 41%. The proportion who say they can speak some words of Gaelic has doubled from 15% to 13%. So I think there is evidence to show that there is movement in the right direction. But I think it's also safe to say that there is more work to be done, and there is there's probably a need to be doing different work in different areas, particularly in the areas of the country where Gaelic has its traditional heartlands, and that there is a challenge in these areas in particular, just because of the economic and other challenges that are being faced by those communities. But I think the interesting thing is that while Gaelic may have been considered a marginal issue in those communities in the past, or a more marginal issue, that Gaelic is actually moving to the centre of the challenges, or maybe to the centre of the solutions that are available for our traditional Gaelic communities. So I think while there is a big challenge there, in recognising that challenge, there's also a big opportunity for us to do something different and to do something about it.
I would say that opportunity award was probably my reading of the Social Attitudes Survey. I mean, there seemed to mean that there was demand in the population. So people, and actually I think a welcome acceptance perhaps of Gaelic as a part of national culture, and that people felt that it should be promoted, which is, in my view, a very positive thing. But do we have the resources, and do you have the authority as a board to try and meet that demand?
I think you probably know what I'm going to say. Gaelic needs more resources, and the board gets a very small percentage of the whole Gaelic budget, but all of Gaelic needs more resources. We are also conscious that resources are tight at the minute, so we need to look at other ways of developing and moving forward without always looking for more resources. And I think that's one of the tools we have for that, is looking at how the plans can be used. The national plan gives the big picture, but the ones that are the real toolkits are the plans that all the national bodies and the local authorities will have, and ensuring that they are smarter and that there is a clearer understanding around the expectation from them, I think is a very clear and definite way. At the moment, the board does not have the responsibility or the ownership of the plans. If targets are not met, if ambitions are not achieved, we refer them to the minister. And we've started doing that for the first time. We have developed over time ourselves and are beginning to realise we need to be really taking a hard line on many things, because things at various levels are not moving fast enough. So how that will look, we have thoughts on that too, and particularly in terms of strengthening the powers of the board through the Act. And we are conscious that the functions and structures of the board are on the programme for government list, so it is a good time to be looking at that. And I think my answer to your question is we need more resources. We are also pragmatic, so we need to look at other approaches, and we have thoughts around that.
Thank you. Thanks, Kabira.
Thank you very much, Michael. I've got something to follow up on that, actually, Mary. It's, you spoke there about strengthening the powers of the board and using... How do you see that developing, and what would you like to see developing in terms of that?
I'm going to call an end to it.
I think that's what you call a hospital pass. I think the biggest challenge, I think, that we're faced... I mean, I've worked in the public sector now for nearly 40 years, and I've yet to come across a public sector body that couldn't do with more resources to do with what we want to do. But I think the challenge for Bord na Gaelic at the moment is that we are required to work collaboratively with a whole range of organisations, a whole range of people, sometimes with very conflicting priorities in these groups and communities. I think where we do have the planning mechanism, for example, we do need to be able to strengthen that, to make. I mean, I'll maybe be a bit cheeky just now, convener, and I apologise for the cheeky bit, but it's a good example. But as you mentioned at the beginning, that we're not able to conduct today's meeting in Gaelic, we will be probably subject to a lot of criticism for maybe for what we say or what we don't say today. The biggest criticism we will face is the fact that we did not conduct ourselves today at this committee about the Gaelic language in the language. And while you know, the Parliament has a language plan, the language plan is an approved language plan, and it allows the discretion of the convener in terms of using Gaelic for us to give evidence in Gaelic. But when we're actually conducting business, when we're talking about Gaelic, when Gaelic is the subject, there should be no discretion. I think that if we are seriously going to take Gaelic seriously, we shouldn't have that discretion exercised when the subject is Gaelic. And again, it's not a criticism, it's just the reality of where we are. We need to take a step forward and a step up in terms of us making the best use of the tools that we have at the moment. We've been trying to get this message across in our consultation events. There is criticism that the Gaelic Language Act isn't strong enough, and there are a lot of different opinions on that, but we have to make sure that we use the Gaelic Language Act to the full extent to make sure that the Gaelic language plan that we have for the next 5 years is as robust and practical as it can actually be. We have regulations. We need to use them more. We need to find the right balance between working collaboratively with partners and using the legislation and the regulations. And in the past, we've tended maybe not to do that, to rely more on the collaboration and to keep trying to discuss things to a conclusion rather than using the regulations. We've actually found it very effective in recent months in discussions with other public sector organisations to say, well, OK, if we can't come to an agreement within the required timescale, we have no option but to refer this to minister. It works for most. It doesn't work for all. But it's something that we need to be more focused on in using all the tools that we have. And I think it's something that we are learning more of. We've had more younger people coming out to our consultation events on the next Gaelic language plan. The next generation of people, or maybe the generation behind that, from my generation, are maybe not quite as polite as our generation has been in terms of accepting things, not quite as accepting. They are expecting a lot more from us as a public body, probably from the Parliament as a Parliament, from the government as a government. And we're looking, and we have to respond to that. And our communities, the communities that we work in and represent, are becoming more vocal and their expectations are getting higher.
Thank you for that, Ian. I appreciate the comments. So, can I move on to questions now from Ross Greer, please? Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Going back to the publication of the plan for the current period, 18 to 23, there was supposed to be an implementation plan published with that. Obviously, that wasn't the case, though there were other plans. Your corporate plan, in, to some respect, resembled an implementation plan. Do you think that the lack of that implementation plan, though, has stymied the ability to fulfil all the ambitions of the current national plan?
No, I think it's a different understanding of how we work. The corporate plan came out of the national plan, and out of that came the operational plan. But what is becoming clearer towards, I think, across the country is that the national plan belongs to all of the country, and that the operational plan is the part that Port na Gaelic itself delivers, and that it delivers it with partners, and there were targets in it, and these have been met, and that will be evaluated. It's being evaluated now, and that work is not yet finished because we're at an interim stage with that, and the plan still runs until the end of this year. You want to add, Ian, something to that?
Yes, can I come back in on that as well? I understand the comment about the implementation plan, and I think the intention was what was put in place was the Faster Rate of Progress initiative, which was led by the Deputy First Minister. And the purpose of the Faster Rate of Progress initiative was to bring the bodies together who are required to collaborate to deliver on some of the outcomes required in the plan. So I think that rather than an implementation plan, because it's not just a plan for one body, that the implementation plan itself isn't a straightforward thing. It's not a, it needs to be a bit more holistic. So I think the Faster Rate of Progress was put in place for that to take place. Whether that's been as successful in delivering the same outcomes or not is maybe another question.
Jim, were you looking to come in as well?
Just to add to that, absolutely. I think Faster Rate of Progress is a key element in terms of this much greater understanding that there requires to be that Bord na Gaeilge, with a staff team of around 25 people and 19% of the budget, cannot deliver the national plan and should not deliver the national plan because it's the national plan. Yeah. It's not Bord na Gaeilge's Gaelic plan, it's the national plan. That stat I gave you earlier on, with 30 of the 32 authorities either having Gaelic language plans or in the process of creating them, that is definitely a role for us to be working with these local authorities, for instance, in education, because local authorities deliver education. So if there's a target in the national plan to increase the number of young people in Gaelic medium education, Bord na Gaeilge cannot order that to happen. The Scottish Government can order that to happen, but a set of organisations, GTCS, Education Scotland, local authorities, Stirling Náisiúnta, which is the national agency that looks at Gaelic medium resources, there's a whole variety of organisations, they are then in charge with delivering that. And that raises some quite complex issues. And without casting any comment on whether this is right or wrong, Glasgow as a local authority has a cap on Gaelic medium education. So approximately 180 children have applied for P1, and the authority has decided that there will be a cap on Gaelic medium education at 140. Not saying that's right or wrong or making any judgment on it, that's simply a matter of fact. That impacts on the national plan, because if the national plan says we should increase the opportunity and the range of Gaelic medium facilities, well, there's an example where an authority has made a decision that that will not happen within that authority at a certain level. Now, I'm trying to be very careful not to comment on the internal reasons why that cap exists, because I think there are balanced arguments between whether that's a good thing or a bad thing in terms of the actual cap. But it's the statement of fact that the board doesn't have the ability to say you cannot have a cap, or you must do this, or you must do that. It's based on the Gaelic language plan for Glasgow, which will come up for review. Another example is learning the language. So we are working with local authorities on targets for L3. L3 in Scotland has seen a decline in terms of Gaelic, and we as a country really need to reflect on our performance as a country in comparison with Wales or Ireland in terms of learning the language. We do not do well as a country regarding that. So we're working through GLPs, which is practically the only way we can really work Gaelic language plans with local authorities. And recently, for instance, I'm talking last month or two, through some quite challenging discussions with North Lanarkshire as an example, a target of 40% was agreed for L3. Now, that means just over 50 primary schools in North Lanark through the lifetime of the next Gaelic language plan for North Lanark, they will develop in just over 50 primary schools
Gaelic is an L3. That's a huge advance for the language in North Lanark. It's a big task for the local authorities, a very challenging target for the local authority. Absolutely hats off to them for ultimately agreeing to that target. And that will require a whole set of other organisations, Education Scotland, a range of other organisations to support in terms of resources and training for teachers to enable them to do that. So these things are quite complex, but they actually are, they influence each other. I think that's a particularly good example, which we will be working with other local authorities on in terms of targets for L3. But in the end, if an authority, as Hoorstan Carrick, as the chair said there, if an authority, and there are some examples live currently, where authorities are not willing to meet the challenges that North Lanarkshire have met, and they're not willing to do that, our only recourse is simply to refer that to Scottish ministers. There are no enforcement powers or anything like that, as there would be in other countries. And that is a thing for Scotland to reflect upon. Should there be enforcement powers, and where should they lie if that were to happen?
If I may comment on that. I think you, hopefully you're getting the picture that Gaelic development is a very complex landscape. This consultation on the next national plan is open until the 26th of July, and we would welcome your contributions either as individuals or as a committee or under any other hat that you would like to submit your contributions online. We would really, really welcome that. And again, like to thank you, and we'd be very happy to hear your question, you know, your suggestions today as well.
Thanks very much. What really struck me, particularly from the latter part of Jim's answer, there was the importance to the success of your ambitions of the local authorities, GLPs, but I presume there's no synchronisation there. They're all setting them at different times in the cycle. How does that impact on the fact you have a relatively standardised five-year rolling plan to develop? How does the fact that you've got 32 different local authorities setting them for different periods of time at different points in time, how does that impact on your ability to set a five-year national plan?
That's a really difficult question. I'm going to get Ian to answer that one as well. He's new in the job. He's new in the job.
Yeah, so give the new guy all the difficult question. I think there is a challenge in that, but there's also, again, there is also an opportunity as well. And I think a lot of it comes back to the hope that we're actually starting to see coming through in the attitudes of people and the knowledge of people want to see. There are more and more people now want to see Gaelic increase and Gaelic improving. That, in a way, should put some pressure on the individual public authorities, as should the plans. I mean, the way I say it, I worked in local government long enough to know that that if peer pressure is quite a significant and a useful tool, if it's used in the right way to encourage growth and increase. So there are opportunities in the different timescales in which to grow and to crank things up year on year. I don't think we maybe haven't had the same hope and expectation coming from the people of Scotland that we do now. So maybe there is an opportunity in that to use that to encourage. And as Jim used the example there of North Lanarkshire, in reality, that should give us a spur. And my experience always was that if one local authority takes an action, then other local authorities will be looking to improve and to go one step further. So we should be looking to see to make the most of that opportunity. And in some cases, you know, we just have to work with whatever cycles the other public bodies are working with. And while there are challenges, there are opportunities.
I think also, particularly over the lockdown period, The board has worked closely with key Gaelic organisations and also has Deputy First Minister and MSPs and the cross-party committee have sort of reached out in a way that hadn't happened before. And we get the message from our community as we've been going around the country with this consultation, and we have been far and wide, that people are really sitting up and taking an interest, particularly the attendance by young people. And that's people who have come through Gaelic media and themselves, who are also seeing the wider thing that, and this particularly goes back to round about the traditional communities. Gaelic as a language doesn't stand alone. It needs a house, it needs a ferry, it needs a road, it needs a strong economy. And we are now looking at Gaelic as something that probably glues all these things together. But Gaelic life is just normal life. But it's important that we are listening and we are hearing that from people. And we are taking these messages to the government and to the parliament. And this is a huge opportunity for us and for you to feed that into the national plan, because the language needs everything else for it to move forward and to develop.
Thanks very much. Thank you, Ross. Can we move over to Ruth Maguire, who's joining us virtually? Thank you, Ruth.
Thank you, Convener. Matinva, ha Magavilshif Colerain and you. A question I can be in Fallam Gaelic. Good morning. I'm really glad that you're with us today. I've got some questions about Gaelic education. And before I begin, I just want to agree with the comments about use of Gaelic in the Parliament. I am sorry that you've not been able to give your evidence in Gaelic. I don't think it's good enough that Scotland's Parliament can't conduct its business in Scotland's language. So let me delete mention. Sorry about that. One of the great successes, I think, has been Gaelic medium education in terms of growth, and I should declare an interest that both my children, although grown up now, were educated at School Gaelic Glasgow for primary and secondary school. I am an Ayrshire MSP now, and I'm delighted that we have Brunscoil Whitehurst, a primary school in Winning. Now, it's parents that drive that, it's not bodies. The parents start the nurseries and playgroups, and then the demand grows from the community, which I think is part of the success. Can I ask what the overall goal is for the breadth of access to Gaelic medium education? And Jim Wannell spoke there about a little bit about the role of the board, but if you could expand on that a bit for me, that would be helpful. Thank you.
Ruth, hear me a Jim Thicker Stuart.
Yeah, I guess we'll continue in English, but Vashin Ma. The vision that we would have is quite simple and quite clear. Everybody who wishes to have their child educated through the medium of Gaelic should have that opportunity. It's not complex, it's not difficult. The complexity is in the delivery of that. So that would be our vision. Our view is that there should be much wider realisation across Scotland that within this country we deliver education in the medium of two languages. And parents make a decision, make an option at the age of five, normally, which language they would like their child to be educated in. And they have two choices, either through English or either through Gaelic. That means, consequent to that, that a set of national agencies have tasks and responsibilities to ensure that's deliverable. And local authorities have that as a task, that that's deliverable across the country. There should be no postcode lottery as to whether you can or cannot access Gaelic medium education. We, as I've said already, a majority of local authorities now either are delivering or are preparing the delivery of Gaelic medium education. There's a whole range of other things happening which require a lot of focused attention. Teaching force development is a key element. And we are seeing that where there is demand for Gaelic medium education, for instance, in rural areas, Mary's already mentioned there, housing, transport, those kinds of things. So we have currently an application under the statutory guidance in Applecross, to use that as an example. The local authority have advertised have not been able to appoint, and they're about to go to re-advertisement. A majority of the parents in the local community are seeking Gaelic medium education for their children for the first time ever. We are supportive of that, and I'm actually meeting with those parents tomorrow night. We will continue to support and encourage that development. However, the creation of Gaelic medium education in an area like Applecross is not a simple task. It does require somebody to be attracted to what is a relatively remote part of Scotland. They need to have housing, they need to have other sorts of supports, and they need to be ready to do that. So that requires some additional thought. Corlian na Gaeltacht, the Highland Council, are very actively involved in promoting that and trying to address those issues. But that isn't as necessarily as easy to deliver as it may be, for instance, in Glasgow or Edinburgh. And there are specific difficulties in Glasgow and Edinburgh around the very large number of people who are seeking Gaelic medium education. I think one of the issues to be completely cognizant about is that the delivery of education, responsibility for that lies with local authorities. And that's the key mechanism that we need to access to ensure that Gaelic language plans and the ability of the local authorities and the willingness of the local authorities is really, really obvious to us all. One of the things we as a board do is, and we've become far more active over the past number of years in doing this, is responding to public consultations. And if anybody wants to see the large amount of work that we have been doing in terms of public consultations, they're all on our website. So, for instance, there's so many examples, but recovery from COVID-19, we responded to all public consultations on that with a specific focus on Gaelic medium education and what we would expect and support and encourage local authorities to be doing. GTCS have just in January, there was a public consultation about registration of teachers, and that raises some really important issues about additionality for our Gaelic medium workforce, who don't have recognised additionality in terms of registration at the GTCS, and we are proposing very specific things about that. Ken Muir Professor Muir has done a massive amount of work in terms of his reports and the subsequent things that are happening within the whole national framework of educational organisations. We have responded to all consultations and continue to do that to ensure that there is an understanding that Gaelic medium education is part of the Scottish national delivery of education. And that's a crucial element, that there's much wider understanding that when any organisation is set up, for instance, the new qualifications organisation, that the organisation is set up with a perspective for both delivery through the medium of English and through the medium of Gaelic. And that would be the prism through which we would look at all development, that there's a firm understanding that young people in Scotland, families seeking education, who are registering for education, they have the ability and the competence to do that, choosing either Gaelic medium or English medium delivery. And that does raise some questions and some challenging questions for authorities like Edinburgh and Glasgow, who are having difficulty in delivering those responsibilities. But nevertheless, we're here to provide professional advice and support whenever we can about that.
Ruth, sorry.
Thank you, Convener. How close are local authorities to ensuring that Gaelic medium education is available in and this quoting from the papers here, 50 civil parishes with 5% or more Gaelic speakers?
83% is the current stat. Obviously, parish boundaries and school catchment boundaries aren't the same, so it's a bit of looking at, and our stats officer has recently looked at that to update awareness of that. So the current stat is 83%, and that means that within those parishes there is either Gaelic medium education or it's close by, that still means there are 17% that we would encourage local communities to look at Gaelic medium education. Applecross is just a really nice example, because there we have a situation where the local authority, the board, the local community is actively seeking to develop a new service in quite a challenging and quite remote part of Scotland. Even if somebody lives quite close by, if anybody knows Applecross and the drive into Applecross during the winter, that's going to be quite difficult if somebody doesn't actually live in that community. Nevertheless, we are all working together to try and deliver that, and that is still a challenge. So those kind of complexities around housing, around transport, around the willingness sometimes of people to relocate. Ardnamurchan is another area where there is a demand for Gaelic medium education and there are significant staffing gaps. And there are significant staffing gaps in Glasgow, so it's not to say that that isn't the case in urban local authorities, because you need to reference that against the demand, which is very high in some urban local authorities. But in terms of that specific question, 83%.
Ruth? And you gave the example of Applecross there. So Applecross, there are 5% or more Gaelic speakers in Applecross?
I need to just check. I'm 98% certain, yes, that is the case, because the stat would be 2011 census, not the current one. And I'm sure Applecross is one of those areas. Yeah. Okay. If it's not, thank it's you. Beside.
Okay.
More questions, Ruth?
And one final question.
Yes. Go. Thank you. Yes.
Around adult learners, can you say a bit about the discrepancy between the number of adult learners reported by the board in reports for 2015 to 2019 and the numbers reported for online resources?
Jim? That's quite a complex picture. You can see the numbers for adult learners in the 2015 to 2019 period. Acquiral of statistics has been quite complicated within both adult learning and in terms of Gaelic medium education itself. So, for instance, with Gaelic medium education, we conducted what essentially was a national survey, and that did throw up some interesting things. Sometimes, for instance, in 1 year, a local team would register a child in Gaelic medium, although they were also attending English medium early years provision, for instance, so they'd make a personal decision as to whether, because they had morning sessions in Gaelic and afternoon sessions in English, which system they were registering in, and then they might change their mind the year after, and that would look as if there had been some decrease in Gaelic medium, and that wasn't the case. That's because the uplift of stats was through surveys which the board conducted. We're moving away from that, and we're now working with ScotExed, and we're working on national stats, and we will work... the national stats that we will produce will be ScotExed material. ScotExed did not always uplift the required materials that we would need, but the team have been very, very open to changing that. So that will happen. There'll be an interim period where we will have an interim report using ScotExed GME stats, and then we will refine that because they've already agreed to change that. In terms of online learning and Gaelic learning, that is a kind of similar picture. That was resultant. Those stats were resultant from research we did across local authorities, and that's dependent upon local authority uplifts because there isn't registration in the same sort of way. And that is always going to be difficult to do because that's dependent on the accuracy of that of services within local authorities, which sometimes are not local authority services any longer. They are, for instance, in Glasgow Life would run evening and weekend courses in the language, and they would record certain stats around that, and that would be a picture across the country in different local authorities. What we can do from other sources, such as online, Speak Gaelic, for instance, which is just under 400k footfall across social media platforms, they also measure how long people are on those platforms. So it's not just accidental entry onto the longevity of the stay. It can be mentioned, it can be assessed as well. Learn Gaelic also has stats, which are very encouraging. They showed a big increase during lockdown, which again is quite interesting. When people had the time, the opportunity, they were very up for doing this. Other things happened whenever lockdowns came to an end, but that was quite an interesting thing when we saw the change. One of the questions, reflective challenge questions for the country is, how do we capitalise on that clear evidence that people online want to learn the language? And how do we capitalise on that through other opportunities to learn the language, sometimes face-to-face, and that's more difficult to deliver because that is dependent upon face-to-face opportunities and tutors and that kind of thing. And we do know that local authorities, as with teaching teachers and early years workers, are having difficulty in recruiting enough tutors to keep up with demand. So that's, again, a task for local authorities to seek support from ourselves as the specialist agency, but also looking for additional resources, unquestionably.
Thank you, Jim. I think, on that subject, can I ask CoCab Stewart to come in? I think she's got some questions relating to that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, that's a perfect place for me to pick up on. I just wanted to sort of go into that. You've talked about the challenges of recruitment of teachers. So I just want, could one of you or all of you make any comment and give us further information about what is being done to attract, to retain, to train in order to increase the number of Gaelic teachers?
Thank you. I think that's definitely a question for Jim. He's the Director of Education.
We, Bord na Gaelic runs a number of initiatives, and I'll run through some of them, but prefaced by the responsibility for employing, recruiting and employing all teachers lies with local authorities. The responsibility for registration lies with the GTCS. The responsibility for support and development lies with agencies such as Education Scotland, SQA, who provide support and development. So there's a whole range of responsibilities that feed from the national plan. And it's absolutely crucial to establish that from the onset. As I've said, an organisation of 25 people cannot reverse 400 years of decline in the Gaelic language in Scotland. It can provide expertise and really important developments for that, but nevertheless, that's the big picture. Those major organisations whose responsibility it is to deliver the national plan. In terms of some of the things the board's been doing, we run an education grant scheme. And that's got so anybody who's registering in a Gaelic related course can apply for attractive funding from us, numbers for that uptake of that scheme continues to be very healthy. So any student teacher on an ITE programme, for instance, is able to apply for that. Strathclyde University has recently been funded to run an ATQ. Initial teaching qualification pilot, and that is being done with Glasgow and North Lanark and Western Bartonshire, where modern languages teachers will undertake a course, and that will enable them to be on completion, successful completion of it, they'll be able to register as with Gaelic as part of the modern languages component in their school. We fully funded that pilot on the condition that all schools and local authorities agree to input Gaelic into the curriculum offer. So in Western Bartonshire, St Peter the Apostle is an example. There is a teacher, and there are teachers, six, I think, from Glasgow, different secondary schools in Glasgow, and in North Lanarkshire, two secondary schools. On completion of the course, Gaelic will become part of the modern languages curriculum offer. That will enable a national deficit to start to be altered, because if we get more people, young people in our schools acquiring National 5 and Gaelic learners, They are then going to get degrees. They then hopefully might choose a job in Gaelic medium education, and that will help local authorities to fill their vacancies. So it's that kind of we need a second wave. I noticed in Ireland and Wales, particularly in Ireland, when Irish visitors came to Scotland, they were quite jealous of the fact that the vast majority of our workforce had Gaelic as their first language in Gaelic medium education. We were quite jealous when we went to Ireland and Wales that they had a very significant proportion of Welsh and Irish learners in their workforce because they'd attracted two labour markets into their workforce. We in Scotland have historically not been able to do that very well, so that opens up that opportunity. We also support, through a funding scheme, immersion courses for teachers. So there are three immersion facilities: Glasgow University, SMO, and Lewis Castle, which is a new name in the Western Isles. And they run year-long immersion courses. If a local authority has a teacher who's an English medium, who's got a beginning level of Gaelic, we pay 80% of the supply costs for them to come on that course for a year, on the guarantee that they move into employment in Gaelic medium education straight away thereafter. So that provides another opportunity for local authorities. Every application for immersion has been accepted and has been delivered. Numbers are quite small. COVID-19 has impacted on that because some authorities have not permitted any teacher to come out for a year to go on an immersion course. We hope that the numbers will return to some greater health as COVID-19 recedes. So that's just an example of some of the things we are doing as a board, but the big picture is local authority.
If I may add a comment to that, I live in a very small community. I live in Uist in the Western Isles, and recruitment and retention is a serious problem, particularly in middle to upper management. And if there are vacancies across the country, as there are many, we become fearful that someone from our community will leave and go, because it's increasingly difficult to recruit people to the remote communities, as Jim has said. And again, I think that goes back to the point that not one size fits all. And it's not only in teaching, but also in various other jobs that are Gaelic essential, management jobs. And we see that at the board itself, that the difficulty of recruiting enough people who are skilled, because if you're taking from one, you're leaving a hole somewhere else. And it's a problem and it's a challenge. And we would certainly like to hear any input you would want in terms of helping us find a way forward for that.
Thank you for that. We're going to, continuing on this theme, I have some questions from Bob Doris. Okay? Is that correct?
Yes. It was on, Deputy Coon was asking about staffing and recruitment. And earlier on, I think Jim Wannell was talking about demand outstripping supply, not just in terms of staffing, but in terms of infrastructure. And as a Glasgow MSP, I was interested to hear that there was 180 requests for a primary school P1 placement, but 140 places available. I know Glasgow City Council got a draft Gaelic language plan out for consultation. At the moment, we'll see a fourth primary school come online in 2024. Can I ask whether local authorities, all 32, what the relationship is between the board and them in relation to their forward planning, not just for making sure there's sufficient staffing, but also there's sufficient infrastructure there? Because I'm conscious, as a constituency MSP, every year I do get requests for letters of support for appeals, for placement requests, for particularly for primary school education, the Gaelic medium. So any information in that relationship, convener, between the local authority, the support, the communication, the, if you like, the quality of the forward planning of each local authority to meet that demand, I'd be interested in any comments about that would be helpful for me as a Glasgow MSP.
In terms of education, really, yeah. I think Jim is... Yeah.
Absolutely, there's a whole range of it. We provide continuous professional support and advice. That's one of our roles. So we work closely with Glasgow. We work closely with a range of local authorities.
And we work with Common and Parent Náisiúnta, and Common and Parent is organised in local groups as well. So we work with the Common and Parent Glasgow, the local group there as well. Obviously, our role is professional support and advice. We have no power to instruct a local authority to do anything. We simply encourage, and we further to encouragement, we can give them opportunities and advice on what might be the way forward. In terms of, for instance, the current issue in Glasgow, that went to statutory review under the statutory guidance, and it went to a full assessment. And part of our responsibility as an organisation, along with Education Scotland and Common and Parent Náisiúnta, is to provide a response to the local authority. And we provided a very in-depth response to the local authority. They decided to do something else, which was not necessarily in sync with the responses, the formal responses from Bord na Gaeilge, Education Scotland, or Common and Parent. But that's our role to do that. I think there are complexities in the Glasgow situation, which we'll continue to work with the local authority on. However, the local authority is fully aware that in terms of our view as a board, we do not agree with caps on Gaelic medium education.
I get to, can I just check one thing, though? When the fourth school comes online, hopefully on schedule for 2024, would that meet the current demand, retrospectively, of course, that we're seeing at the moment? And I get when 2024 comes along, the demand may be greater again. So the local authorities are always playing catch-up infrastructure in relation to that demand. So will 2024 meet that demand?
Can I ask that you be really, really brief with that answer? Because we've got a list of other people wanting to ask.
No, more needs to be done, because the reason that the authority has cited where they're coming from is about capacity in the secondary sector, S1 to S6. So, in short, authorities which are very successful in developing Gaelic medium education need to continue that success. So the fifth school needs planned at this point.
Thank you very much for that, because I've got questions still on this subject from Stephanie Callaghan before we move on to the other members. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks for being here this morning, panel. As the constituency MSP for Uddingston and Bells Hill constituency, I'm absolutely delighted to hear the positive talk around North Lanarkshire Council, and it's great that they've committed to such challenging targets there. I think a lot of local people maybe don't recognise that names like Airdrie and Glenboig come from Gaelic, and that the 11th or 12th century then predominantly we spoke Gaelic too. So we maybe forget that in the central belt of Scotland there. Really interested as well in the fact that there's that commitment in the NLC documents to equal respect.
To a question, please.
Yeah, for Gaelic and English. And Jim said that everyone who wishes to have their children educated in Gaelic can do that. That's the aim. So what I'm wondering is, how far along the road does North Lanarkshire Council's plan and commitments just now take us? If they're successful actually achieving that, how far does that get us towards that aim of parents being able to choose at age 5? Thanks.
It absolutely does in terms of Gaelic medium education. And I met with Common and Parent Lanarkatua, so it's the North Lanarkshire Common and Parent group. And one of the key things in the North Lanarkshire plan is that North Lanarkshire works with parents and with Common and Parent and Lanarkatua. That will be a key element, because there is a number of commitments in the plan from the council, and their full realisation will only take place if that's done in part. The local authority works in partnership with Common and Parent and Lanarkatua, and we will support the local authority and Common and Parent and Lanarkatua to deliver that. But yes, the plan includes things which will definitely move Gaelic medium education on, if they're delivered in that manner.
So just to be quite specific then, would you expect to be at a point, for example, where once this plan concludes, that the next plan actually is looking at parents having that choice from 5 years of age, would you expect it to move that quickly, or is it something that's going to take a bit longer than that?
No, I would expect that to move. Our view would be that within North Lanarkshire, if a family selects Gaelic medium education, they have the ability to get that. What that might entail is travel, and that might be a disincentive. So if there are more services in North Lanark, as there have been in Glasgow, where there's a whole range of services, that the need for travel decreases, therefore the services themselves become more attractive, therefore the numbers going up. In Glasgow we see that, the numbers going up wanting to access services that are more attractive. That will be the challenge for North Lanarkshire to develop new services. They will become more attractive. They will then have more people accessing them, but that's good for the language and it's good for North Lanark.
Thanks, that's a good example.
Thank you, Stephanie. Thank you. That's great. And now can I move on to questions from Willie Rennie, please.
Thanks very much, and thanks for what you do for the language. As I can tell by your passion and enthusiasm this morning that you're great advocates for it. I think we all feel a bit uncomfortable that we're not conducting this session in the language, and I think it's a bit of an insult. And to be honest, we don't need to repeat this again. And if I was you, I'd be a little less diplomatic about that. But nevertheless, let's move on. I'm interested in the wider community engagement. From what I understand, we're making good progress at getting more learners, but we're not making much progress on people speaking it at home. And I'm just wondering what you think you can do to make sure that we can make that kind of progress.
You're looking at me.
You're in charge.
Thank you. Thank you for... I think a lot of it is about confidence, hugely about confidence, and also about success. And success breeds success. And the things that we are hearing about today... It's all about success, but with success comes challenge and then comes opportunity and so on. There's not a straight answer to that, but as more and more people are educated in the language, they themselves will have confidence. And the other, one of the challenges is the learner versus the native speaker, which is the Jim versus myself type of scenario. And there needs to be a balance. As in the communities, there needs to be a balance as well. As we have been talking to many communities across the country, everyone respects and values the other. The rural communities, which are very sparsely populated, need people, but need policies that will make that change. So it's about economy, it's about impact of Gaelic, and it's about developing these communities that they will have a confidence. And in that confidence, they will be speaking the language, singing the language, and seeing the economic impact of it. And we do see that. We particularly see that in our rural communities. The board has something like maybe 50 officers. Many of them are, most of them are at work in the Western Isles. And they are speaking the language with the young people. Much more needs to be done. But we think we are breaking the back of it, but more needs to be done, and we are getting a better understanding. The board is also getting closer to the communities, and we are then able to bring the messages from the communities to the Parliament, as we are doing to you today. So I think it's just a progressive thing. There's not a straight answer, but I think it's a case of keep going, building confidence, showing where the difference is, and telling the stories.
Do you think there's a bit of a tension between those traditional communities who have spoken the language and those who, you know, with the initiative to spread the language across the country? You already talked about potentially losing a teacher from your community who would go off and teach elsewhere. Is that resented locally? That somehow, you know, they'll lose out because of the success of the language elsewhere?
I think Ian's itching to get in here, so I'm going to let him have a go.
I think, yes. Are there tensions? I think tensions have been created. Are there differences? Yes, there are differences. I think Gaelic's a very interesting language, and it is interesting, the discussion when it comes round to learners and native speakers. I too am from a Gaelic community. Gaelic's my first language. And like a lot of people, I wasn't working in Gaelic until very recently. And for someone who was brought up in the language, in a community and with a tradition where we were told constantly that to get on in life, we had to get up and get out. We had to set the language aside and focus on English. There was a lack of confidence. I know that from my own experience. I was intimidated by people who'd learned the language and who knew more words than I did, who knew the vocabulary, who knew the various, you know, the technical bits, which I still don't know and I never will know. But I can speak the language, I can speak the language comfortably, and as I use it more, I am becoming more used to doing that. So we have people like myself in the position that I was in, intimidated by people who've learned the language. We have people who've learned the language, intimidated by the fact that there are people like me who have no problem with the sounds and who can speak to their heart's content, and we are, you know, we're quite comfortable to speak. So you have this strange situation where you have two sides, if you like, who think that the other is better off and better than them. It's the only language that I know where people are obsessive about correctness in terms of speaking it. And if we were as obsessive as our English and our use of English, none of us would speak it. And I think there is a need, there is definitely a different need in our traditional communities to do something different, to raise that confidence. But it is connected with everything else. And I don't think, it's not that there is a tension. It's just how do we find a way of encouraging people to relax so that we can actually use the language? And I think that's why it is equally, and I know that we are on an education committee and the focus is on education. I think a lot of the assumption is that the focus is always on learning. But actually, those of us who were born and bred with Gaelic need to learn. We need to learn something different. Okay, we don't need to learn the mechanics of the language. We don't need to learn the sound. But we do need to actually learn that there is value in what we have. I still live in Stornoway. I know an awful lot of people who will understand absolutely every word of Gaelic but will not utter a word because they are petrified that if they do, they will be criticised by... Because we've just developed this culture. We need to break that. We need to move on. And we do need to use the value of Gaelic, and it is valuable.
There can't be anything more intimidating than Mary, though, surely. So I'm interested, just moving on. There was a proposal for, I think it was perhaps on Sky, for a community, you know, a housing development that would just be for the speakers of the language. Is that something you would support? Do you think that would be a positive development?
I think we need to be very careful about things like that. Very careful indeed. And attracting people to the islands, we need to be very careful about that as well. How land is acquired and so on, we need to be very, very careful around that too. And it's certainly not ruling anyone out, but it's bringing many more in. That's what I would say.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks, Vernon. Thank you for the answer. I'm looking at the clock, sorry, Ian, and I'm very aware that Graham Day has a couple of questions as well. Thanks.
I'll shrink that to one question.
Okay, thank you.
Chair, and cut to the chase. And it follows on from the line of question Wally had there. Barry, you mentioned ferries earlier on, and you'll be aware, no doubt, that one of the many criticisms of the ferry delivery organisation is that none of the directors live in the islands that they serve. And there are also criticisms that some of the staff whose roles are not geographically specific aren't based in the islands. So I'm just wondering, across the board, how many of the people who are involved in your organisation are embedded either professionally or personally in the traditional Gaelic heartlands?
It's a complicated one. I can take the example of if you... I was a teacher. I know teachers who don't have any children, but are very, very good teachers. So it doesn't... You don't have to be doing it yourself to be able to know what to do. So the fact that Scotland is really quite a small place, although it is surprising that people in the Central Belt know so little or experience so little. And the example is the awful thing you've all been suffering with the train strike recently. That's daily life in my community. Every time, and I come away a lot, I have to download the app every single day to check. So whether if they lived in the islands, I'm open about that. But I really feel that the system is broken in terms of the ferries particularly. And something needs to be done for people in the islands know what they want. And many of them are mariners and are experienced in lots of ways. But they are not being listened to, or they are being listened to, but their view, nothing is changing. So we need to see change on that.
But in the context, I've perhaps not pitched my question sufficiently clearly. The question I'm asking is about your organisation, because out of the people who are involved in the board, recognising that we're talking about a national plan and to deliver the language across Scotland, but just for my understanding, what sort of percentage of those individuals are actually embedded in the traditional communities, and how many of them? I mean, I see you've got offices in Stornoway, Inverness and Glasgow. So what's the geographic spread of the people who work for the board?
Ian, have you got...
We now have four of our officers in Stornoway, or in Lewis. The only one actually in Stornoway is myself. And I think what we've been able to do is to take advantage of the challenges that we had with COVID, where everybody was working from home. So all four have been recruited since then. So I think there are now more opportunities for people from Gaelic communities to work for Bord na Gaeilge. We're no longer restricted to having an office in Inverness and an office in Glasgow. And I would say this, I suppose, but I would look to encourage that. I think it's better for us. It's better for us if we have more people embedded. But I think other than Bord na Gaeilge itself is only a part of what we use the funding, even that comes to Bord na Gaeilge. 19% of the funding comes to Bord na Gaeilge. Of that, less than half of it is spent on Bord na Gaeilge itself. Through the funding that we provide, there are a large, I think at one point last year, we were funding 59 officers in Gaelic roles. And I would say that half of those were in the traditional communities. But working for other organisations and Gaelic bodies. So, but again, one of the challenges that we have is in terms of our collaboration and making sure that we're working well together. It does help us if we have some of our officers also located in these same communities. So we can establish the... It's all very well having the organisational relationships, but actually the personal relationships add significant value. So we're moving in the right direction in that, and I think we will have opportunities in future to extend that.
Thank you, Kavir.
If I may, an interesting collaboration is our work with Community Land Scotland, which of course impacts very much on the traditional, and we are working with them closely to have more impact on the rural communities as well.
That's great. Thank you very much for that. Mary, you gave us an advertisement for your consultation earlier on and encouraged us all to take part. So may I take the opportunity to, looking at the draft national plan, what measures are going to be in place to determine whether there will be an increase in the use of Gaelic and an increase in the learning of Gaelic, and what sort of levels of increase would you constitute to be a success? And to sort of sum up, I've also got it, and how will you... You spoke also about that only 19% of the funding for Gaelic comes to the board. Okay, so there's obviously lots of other activities that go on. So how will the board evaluate the contribution of all the activities and your individual activities in the plan to deliver your overall aims? And I know that's a massive question to lay last, but if we can get some sort of feedback from yourselves, that would be great.
I'm a mathematician, so I'll hand over to him.
It's very tempting to respond to that by saying, well, it's not our plan, it's the government's plan, and the government approved the plan. But I think one of the things we have to do, I think it was mentioned in the SPICE briefing, is in terms of outcomes and in terms of measuring outcomes. Very, very easy to say. It's been said for a long, long time. Again, my experience in the public sector, we've been talking about outcomes for a long time. And to be honest, getting nowhere close to identifying what those outcomes are and measuring what they are. One of the challenges that we have is the timescale in which we plan and the timescale in which we measure outcomes. I think the plans we have at the moment, we have a lot of things in place, but is 5 years enough to be able to judge the outcomes from the impact of the plan? I would actually take the social attitude survey as being one way of looking at measuring those outcomes. The interesting thing there is that I think the time span between the two surveys, the comparative surveys, is 9 years. So is there a need to look at, in the legislation for our planning, does our planning need to be over the longer term to be able to have, or does there need to be something overarching? We do have to become much more focused on what we achieve with the money that we spend. We need to move the focus away from the money. Yes, everybody wants more money and we can do with more money. But we, at the moment, I think in seeing the change in attitudes, that actually gives us, or should give us, a bit of hope that we can maybe be a bit bolder in terms of setting those outcomes. But I'll do the same thing as I've done in all the consultation events that I've been involved in, and I will actually put that back, because it is a consultation process. Are there things that you as a committee or as individuals believe that we should be measuring? Are there measures that are important to you yourselves, to you as a committee, to our communities? We've been asking the same thing. It's not just a case of plucking things out of the air and just looking to, you know, to go, you know, we've talked. It doesn't matter what we talk about or when we talk about outcomes, our natural instinct is always to resort back to the things that we know and understand, like the number of pupils in Gaelic medium education, like the number of teachers in Gaelic medium education and availability. They're not outcomes. They're outputs, yes. In some cases, they're inputs. But we do have to move our conversation on so we can develop real outcomes. And we have been talking about this at the board in terms of our own developments and looking to work with government to try and develop some of these. But I think, how do you judge? At the end of the day, we have two prime aims. One's to increase the number of Gaelic people who use Gaelic, and the number of people learning Gaelic. We just need to find measures for the two of those and to find the right timescale over which to show the progress, because there's little point in us setting outcomes for a one-year period or a five-year period if it's going to take us 6, 7, 8, 9 years to achieve. So I think we need to develop that conversation, and it is a conversation.
Thank you, Ian, and I suppose I'm very encouraged to hear that your consultation exercise is something that you're genuinely interested in listening to people's views and suggestions, and I think that's, I'm really, really pleased to hear that, so thank you very much. And with that, sadly, the clock has chimed and we've reached the conclusion of our session today, so I'd like to thank you all very much for coming along and your time today. And the public part of our meeting is now at an end, and we will be considering our final agenda items in private. So can I ask members participating virtually to reconvene in Microsoft Teams in a few minutes? Thank you very much and good morning.